Welcome to Make Something with me, David Picciuto, and today I have my buddy Joel from Welded Work. He is a local artist, fabricator, welder, and sculptor. I love your work, and he is going to show us the basics of welding today, which I need a lot of help. So I brought in the expert.
I can help.
All right. I am using the Lincoln 210, and it's got this fancy little screen on here to help you get the settings. But all welders have a little chart here on the inside, depending on the size wire, the gauge of the steel that you're welding, and the gas.
The type of shielding gas that you're using.
Of shielding gas. I don't know what the gauges are here on the bottle, so can you go over quickly what they mean?
Yeah, sure. This gauge on the right-hand side is always going to be what's called the bottle pressure. So that's how much gas you have in your bottle. The gauge on the left, that's going to be your regulator gauge. That's how much is coming out of the cylinder and going to your gun.
Okay. So doing mild steel, I don't know what this gauge should be reading.
Typically with mild steel, I would run a machine like this like between 25 and 35, and you read the red scale for that, and that's CFH.
With your machine on, if you pull the trigger on your gun, you can see that needle move a little bit probably, if you just give it a quick shot. So it just went down a little bit. You're gonna have to basically pull on the trigger, okay, and then dial in the number that you're looking for. So I'm gonna turn this down to like 30. I think that's a good spot.
This particular machine has this crazy menu set up. This is for dummies like me, but we are doing MIG steel C25.
Yeah.
So I hit okay. Then it tells me the polarity of the setup here. I'm all set up for that. And then we are running 0.03 wire.
Wire, yep.
And then what gauge thickness are we going to be?
Well, on those test pieces that we're just going to run, that's actually 3/16.
Okay.
So yeah, let's kick it up to 3/16.
All right. And so on this particular machine, it kind of gives you settings to start with, and then you can override from there. So otherwise, you would just look at the chart.
Those settings are awesome. They're an awesome start, but you're gonna wanna use your judgment to figure out what the best setting is.
That's why you're here, because when I was welding up the table, my judgment was not working. And I just don't know what I'm looking for yet.
Yeah, so. Yeah. So as you get into it, you'll start to hear what a good weld should sound like, okay, and then you can adjust from there.
All right, so what I just did there was took off some of that mill scale and exposed the shiny bright metal, because otherwise that mill scale can screw with your welds a little bit. And just knocking a little bit of that corner off gives you a little bit more of a groove to lay your weld into,
okay,
which will mean more penetration and stronger weld.
I was going to give you a stone, and you said you have the flap disc, and that's better for this particular application.
Yeah, right? Yeah. I prefer these because, I mean, there's a lot of reasons. There's a safety reason, which we talked about a little bit, and that's that the grinding stones can sometimes break apart and they can explode while you're using them. It actually hasn't happened to me, but I've heard a lot of old timers talk about how it does happen.
Okay. So, all right, I don't want that.
That's where you get all your information, is from the old timer welders. So one more grind I'm gonna do is just a little bit where we're gonna put this, because what we're doing is creating a T-joint, which is a really great learning joint. First thing I'm gonna do is, since we were testing this, we've got all this stick out, and so I'm gonna cut that off right away. There's a rule of thumb as to how far that should stick out, but this looks good to me. It's about a quarter inch, maybe.
Okay.
Maybe a little bit more than that.
Okay.
That should work. So we're gonna put together like a T-joint for some practice here.
Okay.
I'm just gonna use a magnet to kind of hold it at a 90 degree.
Let's talk about where we're gonna put the tacks.
Oh yeah, the tacks.
I get confused where they should go.
Right. Yeah, so it is a good idea to place tacks like in a somewhere where it's not in the line of the weld you're going to do in the future.
Okay.
So like for this, if this was our finished joint, I'm going to put the tacks kind of towards the end on each end.
Okay.
And then that way when we come through, we don't run over that tack like it's a speed bump.
Okay.
So.
All right.
Typically, you want the tip of your gun to face right into the middle of that joint. So that means with a T-joint, you're 45 degrees from the top plate and 45 degrees from the bottom plate. Keep your nozzle straight up and down. As you start to move, you're going to give it a little lean.
Oh.
And that's good.
Okay.
So that's why I always start straight up and down.
Is that allowing the gas to build up?
I don't really know. I don't know about that, but I know that as I was taught, they always said you want a little bit of a travel angle. So as you push, you want a little angle pushing in. That same angle is good for dragging as well.
Okay.
And then that's like a whole other subject, pushing and dragging. It doesn't really matter much which one you're doing.
Okay.
Unless you're doing some special application. I was kind of doing circles, and basically I was watching that molten puddle develop and kind of kiss both pieces, the upper piece and the lower piece.
Oh.
Because then I know that if I catch both of those, then I've melted both of them.
Okay.
And they should be tied in together. Sometimes when I teach people the circle technique, the first thing I see them doing is like moving the gun really exaggerated.
Yeah.
So just think about that. Keep it kind of tight as you're moving along.
Okay.
All right. So let's talk about it.
Judge me. Judge me.
So right away, I think you were moving just a little too slow.
Okay. Because it's pulling up.
Yeah, because it's definitely big, and you maybe you couldn't see that you were hitting only the top ledge. So that little gap down there means you were not touching for the majority of your weld this bottom plate.
Yeah. Okay. I can see where practice is going to come in handy here.
Yeah.
Right.
So this is a great start, though.
That felt a lot better. I could actually feel it hit both pieces as I was going.
Yeah, so. And that looks like totally amazing. Something, something just like clicked.
Oh, go on. All right. Yeah.
No. That looks like that looks better than the thing that I just laid there.
All right. So I'm gonna try, so I can get that muscle memory. I'm gonna try to.
Try to do that same thing all the way down. Yeah, yeah.
But I think the main thing for me was I could feel it hit both pieces as I was circling.
Absolutely.
What do you think?
Yeah, those are both great. All right,
so that's going to hold together pretty well?
I think that's going to hold together really well.
All right.
Color me impressed.
So there, that was Joel's, and then that was my first two attempts. Not very good. No penetration on the bottom piece. We flipped this over and did a lot better here. I can see if I was trying to continue that weld, I didn't do so well making those two beads.
Yeah, if you want to continue a weld, you would just back up a little bit and, you know, overlap them basically before you start again.
All right. Looking good. I think a lot of my audience will use square tubing for pieces of furniture.
Yeah.
I know I'm going to use a lot of square tubing, so I want to do another T-joint and go over welding these two pieces together.
Okay. So first thing is always prepping your pieces. Like, we just cut these in a chop saw.
Right.
So they always leave like these razor sharp burrs on them. You just want to remove those so you have the best chance of making your connection a good connection. So I'm going to go ahead and take care of that right now. Not to mention that also we'll put like a tiny little bevel on it, which is helpful too. Okay. I'm not sure where you got it, but there's always like different types of material that you can buy.
Mm-hmm.
So a lot of times tube will come in with this same kind of gray mill scale on it.
Yeah.
What you have here, I think it's called pickled. So they actually do a process before you buy it where they remove all that.
Huh.
And so you end up with like really clean steel. So we don't have to clean off
the
scale on this.
Let's talk about tacking these two guys up. Where would you put the tacks on this?
Yeah, so for this joint, I would put the tacks kind of close to the corners.
Okay.
And for to keep a T-joint like this really straight, I would tack this corner and then I would go diagonally across to the other corner.
Okay.
Because when you tack it, it'll kind of like want to pull it this way. And if you put the tack on that side, it'll help to pull it back the other way.
Do we need to do all four corners or?
I don't think so. Okay. I think you can do those two and then run a weld across to your tack. Okay. Sometimes you want to start away from your tack and run to it, and that'll, you know, basically it's like tacking this side and then going that way.
Makes sense.
Okay.
Yep.
In the real world, you can't always turn it, so I think you should start in this position because that'll help you to learn technique, but eventually you're going to want to move to where you're doing it in an upright position and in a horizontal way.
Oh yeah.
So that's a totally different joint. We can do that one if you want.
Okay.
So up to you.
Let's do that.
Okay.
Yeah.
So let's start with that one. I'm going to turn this way just so I have the best chance to lay it in there. Mm-hmm. Horizontals are kind of hard.
All right. Are you ready?
Yep.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think that looks great.
All right. I felt I was going a little too slow at first.
Totally.
But I think
totally.
I
saw it. I saw it happen. You were kind of starting to pile up, and you're like, I got to move along.
I got
to
go. We got to go. All right. So, and then maybe I'll, same technique as before, right?
Yeah, same exact techniques as technique as that T-joint.
All right. I'm going to give that a shot.
I would say that you could probably even go a little faster as you start to develop your technique.
Yeah.
I'd just say that the only criticism I'd have of that one is it looks maybe like a little big.
Oh, we burned through.
Oh, we burned through a little bit.
So.
Yeah. And all that says is maybe you could have been going a little faster with it.
Okay.
But, and I think you can probably just fill that in a little bit.
I'm going to give that a shot. I'm going to try to fill that in.
All right.
Try to fix my mistake here.
Totally fixed.
All right. So, how would you clean up this weld then?
To clean up this weld, I would just use like a flap disc like we've been using already.
Gotcha.
The layered sanding discs are the best thing for knocking that down.
All right. Cool.
Or, if you're really happy with the way your welds look, leave them.
Yeah, you don't have to clean them.
Yeah, yeah.
Joel's going to lay three beads. He's going to do one where the feed is way too low.
Yeah.
Then we're going to do one that is too high. And then, as Dan says, we're going to do the Goldilocks one that is just right.
Just right.
All right. Okay, so that didn't have a consistent sound. Kind of sounded like popcorn. And doesn't look very good. So now we're going to go too high. And that sounded aggressive. It sounded like it wanted to fight me. So now we're going to try to dial in the perfect feed. Cool. And you can see the difference in there. So that was the feed. So what happens when you don't have enough voltage or too much?
That's a good question.
Let's see what happens. Terrible. Now we're going to go way too high. And now we're going to dial it in to the right setting. Yeah, big difference in how they look. Another big question that I have is we have two different size gauge. We have 14 gauge and 3/16.
Mm-hmm.
I have no idea how to set the machine. Where do I go?
Okay, so this is kind of a simple thing to do. The rule of thumb is you weld to whatever the thinnest material is. So we will set, in this case, we're going to set our machine for 14 gauge.
Okay. Is there anything about the technique that we're going to change since we're going?
Yeah, I think my technique for doing thick to thin is I tend to want to start on the thick and move towards the thin and kind of kiss it.
This makes sense. Okay. All right.
So those little circles that we're going to do, I'm going to kind of start on the bottom and come up and meet the 14 gauge.
All right.
As I go around.
You mentioned something earlier off camera we'll go back to looking at this here. How much of a weld bead should we lay?
Oh, okay. Like the thickness of your weld bead is determined by the material thickness.
Okay.
So a lot of times people will say, well, that's a really thick weld bead that you laid there. Well, it's too wide or something. And it's like, well, what does that mean? Well, you want to kind of aim towards your weld bead being as wide as the thickness of your material.
Okay.
So even here, we're a little bit wide on it.
Yeah.
But if your goal is to try to get that width, then you're headed in the right direction.
Yeah, yeah.
So I mean, to exaggerate it, if you're going to weld two pieces a half inch together, you need more than a tiny little eighth inch wide bead.
Right.
You need a half inch bead on there,
right,
for sure.
I'd like to thank Joel for coming over. He's a huge supporter of local arts. You teach high school kids, right?
Yeah.
And you do your own sculptures.
That's right.
You're very well known in the community for raising the level of art here around town. So
thanks.
I appreciate that. So go ahead and tell them how they can find you.
Typically I post up to Instagram. So @weldedwork on Instagram is the best way to find me.
All right. Thank you, Joel.
Thank you.
It.